Yeah. This is the record of the first church in Jerusalem. It says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Breaking of bread in this verse is a reference to the Lord's Supper, taking the cup and the bread, which represents the body and blood of Jesus. And that's what he said about it. He said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. So this is why we do this every Sunday. It's because they continue steadfastly in taking the Lord's Supper together. We need to examine ourselves, as it says. We ought not to take this lightly. We ought to know what we're doing as we do it and remember Jesus. So I'll be thinking about him now as we partake the body of the Lord. The blood of Christ by which we have been saved. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your Son. Jesus, I thank you for laying down your life so that we might live by your death, burial, and resurrection. We put our faith in you. You are the blessed hope for which we look, and you are the anchor for our souls in this world. So we thank you. And bless your holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Standing by the road with a heavy load from the seeds he sowed. And if you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, when you're going the wrong way.
Try a little kindness, yes, show kindness.
everyone. It's good to be back with you after being gone last Sunday. And I just want to thank Alan and Marlon for doing such a great job in my absence. The song that I made you listen to just now, by Glen Campbell in 1970, was introduced. This song has often been used by charitable organizations to promote compassion for people who need help. Let me just ask you, who needs help? Everyone. The Glen Campbell song never mentions God as the source of kindness. But kindness is number 5 on the list of 9 characteristics in Galatians chapter 5 that Paul calls the fruit of the Spirit. Can we name them together? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I think I turned you around. I always have trouble with that list. But in any case, it's amazing how the words interconnect in the scriptures. The word kindness, for example, is connected very often with the word gentleness, the word compassion, and the word faithfulness, as well as mercy. And so these characteristics in this list in Galatians 5, they're interrelated. It's all one thing. It's not the fruits of the Spirit. It's the fruit of the Spirit. If he produces one in you, he'll produce all of them in you. And so don't look at this as a checklist. Say, I'm not doing so good in self-control, so I need to work on that one. No, you allow yourself to be filled with the Spirit, and all these things will be produced in you. You can't major on one and minor on another. It's a package deal. Which leads us to ask, how does a person become full of the Holy Spirit? That's the real question, not how am I doing on kindness or some of the other characteristics. You know, all of us experience the kindness of God, and that's the inspiration for brotherly kindness that Glenn sang about. But not all of us are grateful to God for his kindnesses, which explains why men can be cruel to one another. I'm saving the sermon on the kindness of God for Father's Day next Sunday. But please understand that the kindness of God comes first before brotherly kindness. It's what makes that possible. So my sermon this morning answers this question: who does God want us to show kindness to? Well, everyone, but let's break it down a little bit by looking at some verses. In Proverbs, we have a number of verses that say almost like the same thing in different words each time. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 21 tells us to show kindness to the poor and needy. Oh, by the way, if you're going to fill in the blanks in the handout, the outline this morning, I've got 5 blanks here, but I came up with 2 more after I had this printed, so there's 7 groups that we're going to talk about that God wants us to show kindness to. The first is the poor and needy. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 21 says, "He who despises his neighbor sins, but blessed is he who is kind to the needy." Chapter 14, verse 31, "He who oppresses the poor shows contempt for their maker, but whoever is kind to the needy honors God." Chapter 19, Proverbs 19, verse 17, says, "He who is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward him for what he has done." Kind of the other side of the coin of kindness is someone being stingy. And that's talked about in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 6 and 7 say, "Do not eat the food of a stingy man. Do not crave his delicacies, for he is the kind of man who's always thinking about the cost. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you." And finally, Proverbs 28, verse 8 says, "He who increases his wealth by exorbitant interest amasses it for another who will be kind to the poor." So, words of warning and encouragement to us from the book of Proverbs. We should show kindness to the poor and needy. We should also show kindness, secondly, to the very young and old. When it comes to being young, you can't get any younger than being the unborn. And when it comes to the unborn and their treatment in this world today, it is sad, sad story. Because abortion is worldwide, but just in the United States, according to the estimates by the National Right to Life, there have been 62.5 million of abortions in America since 1973. 62.5 million. And we're not just talking about the unborn babies, we're talking about their mothers who are traumatized. Adoption, not abortion, is the loving option. Show kindness to the very young and the very old. This is one of the ones I added later, because I wanted to be sure to get myself included in this in the group of people that you should be kind to. I'm getting older, and one of these days I may be in a nursing home.
I just told him that the other day. We were having a moment.
Perhaps you've heard this poem, which is entitled "See Me." Supposedly, this was found in the possessions of a nursing home resident who didn't have any family visiting him. No friends came to see him. And the nurses supposedly found this poem in the possessions. Sometimes you wonder about these stories as they come to you online. Because I actually found a version of this poem as if it was an old woman nursing home, as well as one that was an old man in a nursing home. I'll read the one that characterizes an old man in a nursing home. "What do you see, nurses? What do you see? What are you thinking when you're looking at me? A cranky old man, not very wise, uncertain of habit, with faraway eyes, who dribbles his food and makes no reply when you say in a loud voice, 'I do wish you'd try,' who seems not to notice the things that you do, and forever is losing a sock or a shoe. Is that what you're thinking?" Did I say shock? Sock or a shoe. Yes, she's there. Okay. Is that what you're thinking? Is that what you see? Then open your eyes, nurse. You're not looking at me. I'll tell you who I am as I sit here so still, as I do at your bidding and eat at your will." And then it goes through the days of his life. When he was 10, when he was 16, when he was 20, what was happening. At age 25 and 30 and 40 and 50. And it continues. "Dark days are upon me. My wife is now dead. I look at the future. I shudder with dread. I'm now an old man and nature is cruel. It's just to make old age look like a fool. I think of the years, all too few, gone too fast, and accept the stark fact that nothing can last. So open your eyes, people, open and see. Not a cranky old man, look closer, see me." I think that expresses, from the viewpoint of the nurse who wrote this was actually written by a nurse, a about the people she cared for in the nursing home. I think this expresses the attitude of God toward the very old. Thirdly, God wants us to show kindness to the widows and the orphans. There's only one verse to read now, and that's James chapter 1, verse 27, that says, "Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." Fourth group are the victims of oppression and injustice. The scripture I'll read for this is Isaiah chapter 58, verse 6. Religious people have always fasted. I don't know whether you do. I don't do it very often. But fasting is, as a religious observance, is, you know, been historically done. And Isaiah chapter 58, verse 6 tells us the kind of fast that God wants us to have. Not a fast from food, but listen. "Is not this the kind of fasting I've chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke." The fifth group of those that God wants us to be kind to are what he calls the least of these, my brothers. This comes from Matthew chapter 25, parable of the sheep and goats. Jesus talking about the final judgment and when all peoples, all nations are gathered before him, he will separate the people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. The sheep on his right, the goats on his left. "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' King will reply, 'I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.'" And so we should show kindness in tangible ways. Not just, go your way, be well, well wishing. The love of God requires that you feed the hungry, that you give drink to the thirsty, that you clothe the naked, that you care about those that are sick or in prison. You know, kindness comes from mentally putting yourself in someone else's shoes. It's living by the golden rule: whatever you would have others do unto you, do unto them. It is getting outside of yourself long enough to really see another person, to understand what they need and to care enough to do something about it. Kindness is free and costly at the same time. It's just as easy to be kind as unkind, but it will cost you more. Book of Job, chapter 6, verse 28, interesting verse. Job 6:28. You're familiar with Job, the great sufferer of the Bible, suffered loss of his children, his possessions, his health. And Job had three friends to come and sit with him, and they wanted to comfort him. But they weren't looking at Job. All they could see was his suffering, and they had to try to explain that away, I think out of sense of hoping it didn't happen to them too. Job chapter 6, verse 28. Job is talking to his friends who have been lecturing him instead of comforting him. And he says, "Be so kind as to look at me. Would I lie to your face?" You know, when you give a gift to someone in need, are you doing it for yourself or are you doing it for them? Because if you're not looking at them, putting yourself in their shoes, having a heart or bowels of compassion as you give that gift, you're doing it for yourself. And there's no reward for that. We need to see people. We need to see those that are crippled in body and soul, just like Peter and John, as they went into the temple at the hour of prayer, saw the man who was lame from birth there at the gate, beautiful. And when he saw them entering, he asked them for money. And it says Peter and John looked at him. And then they said to him, "Look at us. Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he went leaping and jumping and praising God. Later, when Peter and John were called on the carpet for causing a disruption in the temple, he said, "Are we being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple? If so, then let me explain to you what happened." You know, you can be crippled in body or in soul. Jesus saw people who were crippled in soul when he asked his followers to pray for more workers. This is Matthew chapter 9, verse 26. "When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd." You don't have Jesus as the shepherd of your soul, then you're crippled in your soul. That's tough talk, isn't it? That's the truth. Somebody who's always there, who understands perfectly and loves you anyway. Jesus is the good shepherd. And people are like sheep without a shepherd unless they know Jesus as their Savior. And so there needs to be lots of people who are having the same view of the crowds that Jesus had. He looked at them with compassion and mercy, with kindness. And the last group, I just want to make sure everybody's included, because the last group that God wants us to show kindness to are those who are troubled and in pain. Now, you're not always troubled and in pain, but have you ever been troubled and in pain? I think if you haven't been, you will be. So everybody's included in the people that we should show kindness to. Everybody needs help sometimes. Even the Apostle Paul, after all his success in Christian ministry, he needed the help of his friends. And he was on his way to Rome as a prisoner of Rome. And he was put in the custody of a Roman centurion named Julius. And the book of Acts, chapter 27, verse 3, says that Julius showed Paul kindness by allowing him to go see his friends that they might help him meet his needs. Julius, a Roman centurion, an unbeliever in Jesus, showed kindness. think that's in everybody's heart because we're made in the image of God. But it doesn't come out, at least not very often or consistently, unless you're filled with the Holy Spirit. And then as they sailed on toward Rome, a storm came up and they were shipwrecked on the Isle of Malta. And it says in Acts chapter 28, verse 2, that when the islanders saw the shipwrecked victims washed up on shore because it was raining and cold, Paul says they did, or Luke says about it, that they did us this unusual kindness of building a fire for us. I like that. Everybody needs help sometimes. God is good all the time. And all the time, you know, if you want and need kindness from others, you better give it because, and this is the scripture text for this sermon, Galatians 6:7 says, a man reaps what he sows. There are in scripture many verses that could be called life principles. One would be, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Another would be this one, a man reaps what he sows. You want to be shown kindness? Then show it. I want to read that verse in context, Galatians 6, and I'll start at verse 7. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we'll reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Practically the same teaching it can be found in the book of Proverbs. I'm going to go back there. Proverbs chapter 11. I'll be reading starting at verse 17. Proverbs 11, 17 through 19 says, a kind man benefits himself, but a cruel man brings trouble on himself. The wicked man earns deceptive wages, but he who sows righteousness will reap a sure reward. The truly righteous man attains life, but he who pursues evil goes to his death. And, wow, there's a lot more of that in Proverbs chapter 11, but I'll stop there. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 10, interesting verse. A righteous man cares for the needs of his animal, but the kindest acts of the wicked are cruel. Bonnie Theory is our neighbor, and we love her. We love her dogs.
You first, at least.
Let me read that verse again. A righteous man cares for the needs of his animal, but the kindest acts of the wicked are cruel. Bonnie does things for us, we do things for her, little things back and forth, you know. It's been great. And whenever dogs see us come home, they come to the fence. They want petted. So I just can't go in the house without going over and petting her dogs. They give us pleasure. We want to give it back. So that's just a little example of kindness. How it, you sow it, you get it back. And then there's the Eddies, who I think also love animals. Leastways, I know Shirley loves her animals. She names them and holds them.
Sometimes you sleep with them in the barn.
And they love their animals. They take care of the needs of their animals, and they raise what they call guinea hogs. And they raise these and have offered them for sale, like yesterday at Farmer's Market. And I'm just like the Eddies. I love animals of all kinds, beef, pork, fish. We're not talking about PETA people. We're talking about people who care for their animals but keep animals in their proper place. I just want to ask, do we care more about animals than we do people? If we are filled and led by the Holy Spirit, the spirit of kindness, the spirit of Jesus, then we will care about people first and foremost. Are you full of the Holy Spirit? Have you received His presence in your life? Are you kind toward others, toward everyone? No room for gossip, malice of any kind. Be kind to one another. And next Sunday, I'll tell you why you should be kind to one another as we talk about the kindness of our God. The song that you heard at the start of the message, Try a Little Kindness by Glenn Campbell. Can we put those lyrics up? I don't know if I can sing that. If you see your brothers, you want to sing along? If you see your brothers standing by the road with a heavy load from the seeds he sowed, and if you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, you're going the wrong way. You've got to try a little kindness, yes, show a little kindness. Just shine your light for everyone to see. And if you try a little kindness, then you'll overlook the blindness of the narrow-minded people on the narrow-minded streets. I think we'll stop there, Andy. And what's the invitation song? I decided to follow Jesus. Please stand as you sing. Expression of kindness to one of our own who's having a hard time this morning, Bo Belcher. I want to just focus my closing prayer on him and that situation, because he and his girlfriend Shelby, she was like 7 months, going on 8 months pregnant, and the baby had physical problems anyway, she went into labor yesterday and was airlifted to a Children's Hospital, St. Louis, and when they got there was no heartbeat. And so Bo had called me before they left, and very distraught, and I just want to pray for Bo and Shelby right now. Oh, Father, you are good all the time. And I just want Bo to hold on to that. He and Shelby, who has been growing in her faith too, it's got to be so hard right now. I pray that you'd help them get through this day when they get to see and say goodbye to their young one. I just pray you'd be with Shelby's family and Bo's and grant them mercy, comfort, and peace. I pray in Jesus' name.